talks. I'll just give you a glimpse about India's central public sector enterprises, and then a little sort of summary kind of thing as to how Indian public sector has been led. At the time of independence, our leaders felt that only governance, that is administration, cannot be enough for nation building. So they thought that all those areas, all those sectors where private enterprise and private investment will not be coming, will not be forthcoming, government should intervene, government should invest public money and set up public sector enterprises so that those sectors also contribute in nation building. With just a mega 50 crores and 4 public sector undertakings to begin with, this sector has grown to 248 public sector enterprises with a total investment of 600,000 crores plus over the last 65 years. As of now, in fact 2011-12, the total profit of central public sector enterprises stands at 1,10,000 crore plus. They declared a dividend of 50,000 crore, and only 45 of them are listed on Bombay Stock Exchange, and 22% of total market capitalization of BSE belongs to those 45 companies, that is public sector. Therefore, public sector is sizable, contributing a lot, and in fact, when global slowdown was affecting everyone in 2008, India's public sector was raising production, recruiting people, and increasing profits. There was hardly any impact on India's public sector. And even now, European contagion is still persisting. Things are not as rosy as used to be in US, and elsewhere also things are not as looking up. But I am proud to say that our captains of public sector enterprises have really performed very well despite all constraints listed by Mr. Hazara in his presentation. I'll just explain those constraints and why these are there. Because the real owner of India's public sector enterprises is the people of India. They are the sovereign. You and me. Anybody on the street. The poorest of the poor of the country is the owner of the public sector, because it is their money. Government owns the share capital because government is the proxy owner on behalf of these people, representative of these people. And therefore, anybody between the real owner, that is people of India, and the asset may go wrong somewhere, may be vulnerable, may have some deviant behavior. And therefore, all these checks and balances in the form of parliamentary oversight, like Committee on Public Undertakings, Standing Committee, Consultative Committee, then C&AG, Audit. All kinds of checks and balances have been put in place, though at times it appears painful, at times it appears that this is the biggest roadblock or obstruction to public sector enterprises functioning efficiently and more business-like. But because of this structure of ownership, I think these checks and balances have served the India's public sector well, and not all, but some credit goes to the whole system. The public sector performed very well even during 2008-09 global slowdown. Now, coming to MOU system, which Mr. Hazara said, people are not fully aware about the changes public sector has witnessed. Over the years, we have also changed to fixed pay, the public sector executives, and variable pay. We call it performance-related pay, to motivate executives to perform better, to deliver better. And this performance-related pay can go up to 200% of the basic pay of chairman and managing director. And right down to the lowest level, it is 40% of the basic pay of that employee. So the pay structure has been revised in a healthy manner, and in fact it's looking up. And this pay revision took place with effect from 1/1/2007. So we can think that there will be further changes, further improvements in the system. We are also in the process of reviewing and reformulating the guidelines for corporate governance, for corporate social responsibility, for other transparency audit and other mechanisms. One thing which is not visible today to public as well as private sector, which may affect the future of all businesses in our country, and that is penetration of internet. Statewide area networks are getting in place, and by 2013 every single village of this country will have broadband internet available in every village. And you might have had a talk from somebody from Facebook or other social media, the access to information right down to the village level is going to revolutionize the expectation of people. The reputation of businesses and industry going down to the village, because you know, starting with newspaper, radio, television, which had very limited access. Now, whatever happens today to a company or its product or its reputation will reach the remotest villages in no time. Somebody on some social media site will put up that this company has faltered, this company has done that, this company is doing this wrong, and everybody will come to know. And therefore, in this context, we have to reposition ourselves, whether in this public sector or private sector. And for that, I will just take a cue from Mr. Hazra's presentation. The most important ingredient to succeed in this kind of environment is empowering your team, every individual of your team. And this empowerment should not be, you know, limited in any sense. It should focus on making every individual aware about everything. Nothing should be hidden. No secret agendas. Whether it is the worst of employees or the board of directors. Then we have to ensure that these people have the capability, have the skills of analyzing this awareness, this data, so as to place themselves where are they in the context of business. And then we should develop their skills as a leader of that company. It becomes his or her responsibility to make them capable of acting on that analysis so as to deliver better and better outcomes, better and better outputs. If in those 3 A's, awareness, analysis and act, if you could empower your team in your company setting, you have done your duty, you are the best leader, and your company can never falter, your company will always deliver. That is what I wanted to